Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim.
Without much further ado, I'd like to invite Dr. Zakir to continue the lecture. Dr. Zakir.
Alhamdulillah. Wassalatu wassalam. Wa rasulillah wa ala ahli wa sahbihi ajma'in. Amma ba'd. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytani r-rajim. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Udu ila sabili rabbika bil-hikmah. Wal-mu'azit al-hasna. Wajadilun billati ahsan. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. Respected Mr. Arif Sultan, my respected elders and my dear brothers and sisters, I welcome all of you to the Islamic greetings. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May peace, blessings and mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be on all of you. The topic of this evening's talk is Islam and its misconceptions. Islam comes from the root word salam, which means peace. It also means submitting your will to Almighty God, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in short, Islam means peace acquired by submitting your will to Almighty God. Islam is a universal religion, and it's the duty of every Muslim to spread this religion of truth to everyone. But unfortunately, many of us Muslims, in fact, most of us, we shy away from our duty of spreading the truth of Islam. And I started my talk by quoting a verse from the glorious Quran, from Surah An-Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 125, which says, "Udu ila sabili rabbika bil hikmah wal ma'zit al hasna wajadilum billati ahsan." That is, invite all to the way of thy Lord with wisdom and beautiful preaching, and argue with them and reason with them in the ways that are best and most gracious. There are various techniques and methods of doing da'wah, inviting the people towards Islam and conveying the message of Islam to the non-Muslim. Some of them may be less effective, while the others may be more effective. One common methodology used by many Muslims is that they present several good points of Islam to the non-Muslim, which is, alhamdulillah, a good method. But normally, even if you present 1,000 good points about Islam to the non-Muslim, even if he agrees with those good points, yet he will have at the back of the mind, you are the same Muslim who marries more than one woman. You are the Muslim who subjugates the woman by keeping them in the veil. You are a fundamentalist. You are a terrorist. You know, you are the people who don't have pork, who don't have alcohol. These questions will keep on ticking at the back of his mind, and these misconceptions will prevent him to accept Islam as a whole. So what I personally believe and prefer, that whenever I convey the message of Islam to a non-Muslim, whenever I have the opportunity, when non-Muslim comes to me or when I go to him on an individual level, the first thing that I ask is that instead of presenting 1,000 good points about Islam, I ask him that what do you feel is wrong with Islam? With your limited knowledge, with whatever knowledge you have got, whether you have heard it on the television or wherever, whatever limited knowledge you have got, whether from the right source or from the wrong source, what do you feel is wrong with Islam? And many will be shy, will not be comfortable in asking questions, you know, because a Muslim may be hurt. So I am making very comfortable. Brother, you can ask any question. You can criticize Islam. You can take whatever objections you want. Only we want to know the reason. Why do you feel that there is something wrong in Islam? What do you feel is wrong with Islam? And after making him comfortable, that see, alhamdulillah, though I'm a young person, you know, I can take it. You know, young people have hot blood, you know, but alhamdulillah, I can take it. I'm young, but I can take it. You can criticize Islam. You can speak whatever you want about Islam. But please let me know, what do you feel is wrong with Islam? And after he poses the question, if I remove the... And once his mind is empty, all the negative points have been removed. Even if I say 50 good points about Islam, he'll accept it with open heart. So I personally prefer instead of picking 1,000 good points about Islam, first remove the negative feeling which he has about Islam from his mind, and then present even a few good points about Islam, it will make miracles. And alhamdulillah, in my past few years of experience that I have in the dawah field, say approximately past 8 years, I have analyzed that there are a set of about 20 most common questions which the non-Muslim poses about Islam. And whenever any non-Muslim asks you 4 or 5 questions about Islam, invariably these 4 or 5 questions will be part of this set of 20 common questions. You ask a non-Muslim, what do you feel is wrong with Islam? And he'll pose you 3-4 questions or 4-5 questions. Invariably, all these questions will be part of this set of 20 common questions. But naturally, it's based on the Quran and the Sahih Hadith. But many a time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself does not specify the reason why he has prohibited certain things. Certain aspects he has mentioned in the Quran and the Sahih Hadith, certain aspects he has not mentioned. So alhamdulillah, whatever is there in the Quran and Sahih Hadith, I've given the Quraishan. And the remaining Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, use your hikmah. Udu ila sabil rabbika bil hikmah wal ma'zit al hasna wajadilum billati ahsan. Invite all to the way of the Lord with wisdom and beautiful preaching, and argue with them and reason with them in the ways that are best and most gracious. So the remaining part of the answer, I've used human logic to explain why does Islam permit certain things, prohibit the other things, etc. But the final answer, whatever reason we use, alhamdulillah, Allah is the person who knows everything. The final answer is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allahu alam. He is the person who has the absolute correct answer. We use the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the Quran, the Sahih Hadith, and supplement it with a hikmah. But the best answer is known by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These may be the most probable reason why Allah has prohibited certain things or allowed certain things. And I would request that if every Muslim memorizes the answer to these 20 common questions, even if he is not able to convince a non-Muslim to accept Islam or make him realize the full truth of Islam, at least inshallah he will be able to remove the animosity in the mind of the non-Muslim. At least he will be able to neutralize him. So if every Muslim memorizes the answers to this set of 20 common questions, inshallah, he will at least be able to convince 80% of the non-Muslims, 80%. And this set of 20 common questions, how have they been evolved? You know, because you see on the television, on the satellite, in the newspapers, in the magazines, the media is bombarding information about Islam on the television, on the satellite, in the newspaper, in the magazines. And the majority of the media, the international media, is controlled by the Westerners. And they project Islam in the wrong way, not in the true picture. So these misconceptions are evolved around the mind of a non-Muslim by watching television programs, by reading newspaper, and whatever information they get from this media, they think that itself is Islam. So these 20 common questions are based on what the media portrays Islam as. This set of 20 common questions, a few decades earlier, they were different. After a few decades, they may change. So this 20 common questions is applicable for this particular time. And alhamdulillah, whichever part of the world you travel, this set of 20 common questions remains the same. Alhamdulillah, by the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I have traveled to America, to Canada, to UK, to South Africa. Here I'd come earlier, in Malaysia, in Gulf countries, Saudi Arabia, UAE. Alhamdulillah, the 20 common questions are the same. They remain the same throughout the world. As I said, they arise due to how the media portrays Islam as. There may be an additional 1 or 2 questions depending upon the culture of that area or depending upon the surrounding. For example, when I went to States, the common question was that, why does Islam prohibit interest? Which may not come in the 20 most common question, but that's common to that particular locality. Or can we have the meat of McDonald's of USA, you know, with halal or haram? These are additional common questions. And as Brother Arif Sultan said, even here in Singapore, there may be additional two or three questions. You know, depending upon the culture, like he said, the Malay person gets married, they feel that he should wear a particular dress or particular cap, otherwise the marriage doesn't take place. These are additional couple of questions depending upon the locality. But in spite of these additional questions, the 20 basic questions remain the same. And to this 20 common questions, I have added a few questions which are specifically common to the non-Muslims of India.
Sorry, pal. Bar's closed.
About the world. 20% of the world population, they are Indians. And besides that, alhamdulillah, Indians are spread throughout the world. Wherever you go, you'll find them. Even in Singapore, many Indians, in America, in Canada, in UK, in Malaysia, wherever you'll find Indians. So, invariably, and finally, these even become the common question amongst the non-Muslim throughout the world. And inshallah, I've even compiled the 20 common questions asked by non-Muslims who have some knowledge of Islam. You know, those who have read certain books about Islam. And when non-Muslim reads books about Islam, he normally reads books written by critics, by Orientalists, who give a negative picture of Islam. So the 20 common questions that will come in their mind will be additional. Like a few were asked yesterday, you know, that does Darwin theory match with the Quran? And I gave the reply. You know, so these additional questions, like somebody asked me yesterday after the talk, that many places the Quran says Iblis was an angel, one place it says a jinn, is in their contradiction, and I give the answer. So these questions, 20 common questions, arise after reading certain literature of Islam, which have been written by non-Muslims about Islam. So we have another set of 20 common questions asked by non-Muslims who have some knowledge of Islam. And both these set of questions have additional 20 set of questions, which are less common. So you have 40 common questions asked by non-Muslims, 40 common questions asked by non-Muslims who have some knowledge of Islam. And additional 20 common questions asked by Christians, that's another lot. In such way, if we master these common questions, inshallah, we will be able to do dawah very easily and with hikmah. As far as today's talk is concerned, I will only be concentrating on the 20 most common questions asked by general non-Muslims. Time doesn't permit us to deal with all the 20 questions. Inshallah, I'll try my level best. Inshallah, I'll at least cover the 10 most common questions. And in question answer time, if people want to ask the remaining, they're most welcome. As much as possible, the time that has been allotted to me, I will try and cover as many questions as possible. The most common question asked by the non-Muslim about Islam is that why does Islam allow a Muslim man to marry more than one woman? Why is polygamy allowed in Islam? Who agrees that this is one of the most common questions? Raise your hand. Who agrees that this is one of the most common questions? Most common question. Who disagrees that it is not a common question? Raise your hand. See, that's easier. So no one disagrees that it is one of the most common questions, which many of the Muslims may not know how to convince a non-Muslim. He may be convinced himself, but oneself being convinced on his own is different than convincing somebody else. The meaning of the word polygamy is that a person is allowed to have more than one spouse. That's the meaning of the word polygamy. Any person who has more than one spouse, it is called that he is doing polygamy. Polygamy is further divided into two parts. One is polygyny, that is, a man having more than one wife, and polyandry, that is, a woman having more than one husband. So Islam doesn't permit all types of polygamy. It permits limited polygyny. It permits a man to marry more than one woman, limited. And polyandry is prohibited. We'll come to it later on. Why does Islam allow a man to have more than one wife? Quran is the only religious scripture on the face of the earth which says marry only one. There is no other religious scripture on the face of the earth which says marry only one. You read the Bhagavad Gita, you read the Ramayana, you read the Bible. No religious scripture on the face of the earth says marry only one except the glorious Quran. If you read the Hindu scriptures, the sages, the saints, there are several wives. The father of Ram, King Dashrath, he had more than one wife. Lord Krishna, he had several wives, hundreds of them, thousands of them. If you read the Jewish scriptures, they have no upper limit how many you can marry. You can marry as many as you wish. Abraham, according to the Bible, Old Testament, peace be upon him. He had three wives. Solomon had 700 wives. So in the Jewish scripture, you can marry as many as you wish. It was only when the rabbi, Genshen ben Yehuda, in the 11th century, he passed a synod that the Jews should only marry one. But the scriptures say you can marry as many as you wish. And in as late as 1950, in the Sephardic community, where the Jews lived amongst the Muslims, they used to marry more than one. It's only after 1950 that they stopped marrying more than one wife. If you read the Christian Bible, you can marry as many as you wish. It is the church which a couple of centuries ago has put an upper limit, maximum one. In fact, if you read the report of the Committee of the Status of Women in Islam that's published in India, there it said that the polygamous marriages done in India, the Hindus, so the law says, that you cannot marry more than one woman. The scriptures say you can marry as many as you wish. It is the Indian law which was passed in 1954, which says that a Hindu cannot marry more than one woman. The scriptures give permission, no upper limit. It is the Indian government law which, under the Hindu Marriage Act, has said that a Hindu man can only marry one. And according to the statistics of the Committee of the Status of Women in Islam, on page number 66 and 67 of the year 1975, it says that the polygamous marriages done in India by the Hindus was 5.06% between 1951 and 1961. And the Muslims, though Muslims are allowed by the Indian law to marry more than one woman, the Hindus aren't, Muslims married more than one woman, the percentage was 4.31. Hindus 5.06, by law they aren't allowed. Muslims by law we are allowed, and yet 4.31. God knows if the law would have allowed, how many would they have married? So if you analyze, there's no religious scripture on the face of the earth which says marry only one except the glorious Quran. The Quran says in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 3, that marry woman of a choice in twos, threes or fours. But if you can't do justice, marry only one. This statement, marry only one, is only given the glorious Quran and no other religious scripture. The Quran has put an upper limit. Maximum that you can marry is four. You know, before the Quran was revealed, you know, people used to have tens and hundreds of wives. Quran said maximum four. But you can only marry more than one woman if you can do justice. If you can't do justice, marry only one. And the glorious Quran says in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 129, that it is impossible to be just between your wives. I mean, total justice is impossible. But do not turn away from them altogether. That means, you know, here Quran is referring that where it comes to love, it's impossible to be just between two wives. Like a mother, even though she loves all the children, yet she cannot love two children equally. She may say verbally, I love all my children. But if you actually postmortem her views, you come to know that there has to be that the mother loves one child more than the other. Overall, she may love equally. But minutely, there has to be a difference. Similarly, a man cannot love two wives or three wives equally. The Quran says it's impossible to do justice where love is concerned, etc. But otherwise, where other things are concerned, about money, about time, about other things, other commodity, material things, you should do justice between your wives. And as far as possible, even try doing justice where love is concerned. Even though it's impossible, try your level best. And many people think that marrying more than one wife is compulsory in Islam. If you are a Muslim, you have to marry more than one wife. There are five categories of do's and don'ts in Islam. The first is compulsory, that is fard. The second is mustahab, encouraged. The third is mubah, optional. The fourth is makruh, the detestable or discouraged. And the fifth is haram, that is prohibited. Polygyny, a Muslim man marrying more than one woman, falls in the middle category of optional. It is not that if you marry more than one woman, you get more sawab. But if you marry more than one woman and if you don't do justice, you are in trouble. So marrying more than one wife in Islam, marrying more than one woman, is optional. Let's analyze the logical reason what we can think of, why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in His divine wisdom has allowed certain men to have more than one woman. By nature, male and female, they're born in equal proportion. Male and female, they're born in equal proportion. But when you ask any pediatrician, in the child age itself, in the childhood, the female sex can fight the germs and the disease and the bacteria much better than the male sex. So in the children age group itself, there are more male children dying than the female children. So in the pediatric age itself, you find the population of the females more than the male population. As you grow up, deaths take place due to accidents, cigarette smoking, due to war. In these cases, more male are dying than females. So today in the world, there are more females than males. Only in few countries, like the country where I come from, India, and few other countries, where the female population is less than the male population. And the basic reason for this is, a report had come on the BBC, in the program assignment, the topic was Let Her Die. There was a British reporter by the name of Emily Beckenin who said that every day in India, 3,000 fetuses are being aborted after they identified that they're females. That means more than a million fetuses are being aborted in India after they identified they're females. If this evil practice is stopped in India, within a few decades, even in India, the female population will outnumber the male population. Let's analyze the statistics and the ratio of the male-female population throughout the world. In America alone, there are 7.8 million females more than male. In New York alone, there are 1 million female more than male. And today's statistics tell us that the one-third population of New York, they are gays. Gays means sodomites. That means they wouldn't like having female partners. There are more than 25 million gays, sodomites in America, Kameluth. That means, if you analyze, there'll be 30 million females more than males. In UK alone, there are 4 million females more than males. In Germany alone, there are 5 million females more than male. In Russia alone, there are 9 million females more than male. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone knows how many millions of females are there throughout the world. Even in Singapore, if you check the census, there are bound to be more females in Singapore than males. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone knows how many females are more than males throughout the world. Suppose I agree with the non-Muslim who says that one man should only marry one woman, if I agree with him. And suppose my sister happens to live in America and the market is saturated. Every man has found a wife for himself and the market is saturated. Yet there will be 30 million females who will not find husband. 30 million. If you can find a man who has no wife, grab him. But suppose the market is saturated. If you go to America, market is saturated. That every man has found a woman for himself. Yet there will be 30 million females who will not find husband. Now the only option remaining for these women, and suppose my sister happens to be one of them, or suppose your sister happens to be one of them, the only option remaining is that she either marries a man who already has a wife, or she becomes public property. You know, people say, Brother Zakir, public property? What do you mean by public property? I tell them, this is the most sophisticated word I can use. I cannot think of a better word, you know, because, you know, I am a Dai. I have to use good words. I can't use other words, you know. I have to take care of my language. It is the most sophisticated word I can use. And you ask that to any modest woman, that would she prefer marrying a man who already has a wife or become public property? Any modest woman would opt for the first. But when you go to the Western world, you find there that it's very common practice that they have mistresses. You know, on average, if you see the statistics of America, on average, a man has 8 different sexual partners before he settles down with one permanent one. 8. Statistics of America. You know, some may have 20, some may have 30, some may have 1. 8 different sexual partners. You know, mistresses are so common. And when a woman becomes a mistress, that means has sexual relationship without the wedlock, you know, she has no protection. She has no rights. She has no honor. All this goes down the throats of the Westerners very easily. But when we say that Islam allows a man to marry more than one woman, they cannot digest it. When a man marries more than one woman, the woman, both or 3 or 4, all of them get equal justice. They get honor. They get their rights. And alhamdulillah, they lead a dignified life. Whereas if you compare it to the mistresses, they are leading a life which is not honorable at all. So Islam has a solution to the problem of the humankind. That's the reason Islam has allowed some men to marry more than one woman to protect the modesty of the woman, not to degrade her. The second question that can come as a counter question by the non-Muslim is that if Islam has allowed a man to marry more than one woman, why aren't the women allowed to marry more than one man? It's a counter question. Why isn't polyandry allowed in Islam? And Quran says in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 24, that do not marry the women who are already married. That means you cannot marry a woman who's already married. That means a woman cannot have more than one husband at a time. Because if you analyze that if a man has more than one wife, and if any children are born out of this wedlock, you can easily identify who the father is and who the mother is. It's very easy. But if a woman has more than one husband, you can easily identify the mother, but you will not be able to identify the father. And if suppose the mother goes to school to admit the child, and if the teacher asks that what is the name of the father, she may have to give two names. You know what such people are called in our society. And today psychologists tell us that if a child cannot identify the parents, the mother and father, he has mental trauma during childhood. That's the reason the children of prostitutes, you know, they have a very bad childhood, mental trauma. So Islam lays a great deal of importance on the identification of the parents. I am aware, being a medical doctor, that today science is advanced, and by doing DNA testing and genetic testing, it's possible, many a times, to identify who is the father and the mother. But Islam is a religion for all times. This test just came recently. This test wasn't there before. And it is expensive. It's not possible for everyone to do it. It may become cheap tomorrow. But this reason that you cannot identify the parents is at least applicable till today. But this is not the only reason why Islam has not allowed a woman to have more than one husband. This is one of the reasons which was applicable till today, may not be applicable in the future. There are various other reasons. For example, by nature, man is more polygamous as compared to the woman. Third reason is that it is much more easier for a man to perform his duty biologically and physically of being the husband of multiple wives than a woman to perform her duties biologically and physically of multiple husbands. Let me explain to you that in Islam, a man and woman, they are equal. But equality does not mean identicality. They are equal, but they aren't identical. Physically, biologically, they are different. Overall, they are equal. But in certain aspects, depending upon the biological nature, depending on the physical nature, there are certain rules which are different for men, certain rules different for women, but overall they are equal. And you can refer to my cassette, Woman That's in Islam, for more detail. Now, a woman undergoes menstrual period. There are certain hormonal changes. There are changes in her behavior, in her mental behavior. That's the reason, if you know the procedure of divorce, Islam says that during a menstrual cycle, you cannot divorce, you know. There are various reasons, etc. So before the menstrual cycle and during that, the hormonal changes, the disturbances, it's difficult for a woman, you know, to maintain a balance. Even as being a wife of one husband, it's possible. But if she has to be a wife of multiple husbands, it will be very difficult. You know, there are mental changes, biological changes, which is not the case in the man. Therefore, biologically and physically, it's possible for a man to be a husband of more than one wife than for a woman to be a wife of more than one husband. And there are other reasons also. Today, medical science tells us that if a woman has more than one sexual partner, means if a woman has more than one husband, and if all of these people are faithful to each other, that means they don't have any extramarital sex, yet if a woman has multiple sexual partners, there can be certain diseases, sexual transmitted diseases, diseases of the cervix, which can originate if a woman has multiple life partners, even if they're faithful to each other. This is not the case in man. And once the disease originates, it can be retransmitted to the husband. Whereas, in the case of a man, if he has multiple sexual partners, two or three, and if all of them are faithful to each other, if they don't have an extramarital sex, these diseases don't originate. So these are a few of the reasons which I feel that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his divine wisdom has prohibited a woman to have more than one husband. The third common question that can be asked by the non-Muslim is that you Muslims, you subjugate the woman by keeping her in the veil. You know, you keep her in the hijab, in the parda, in the veil, and you subjugate her. You look down upon her by keeping in the veil. In fact, Islam is the first religion which gave rights to the woman. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the major benefactor who uplifted the woman. And if you analyze the history of how women were treated in the previous civilizations, for example, if you read the history of Babylonia, Babylonian civilization, there, if a man murdered a woman, instead of the man punished, the wife of the man was punished. If you read the history of the Greek civilization, the Greeks, they called the woman as the Pandora. Pandora was the name given as a sign of misfortune. And woman in the Greek civilization, she was used only for sex and pleasure. If you read the history of the Roman civilization, there were a lot of nudity and promiscuity amongst the women, and the women were ill-treated. In the Egyptian civilization, the women were considered as the sign of the devil. In the Arab civilization, before the Quran was revealed, the moment a female used to be born, very often she was put to death. Alhamdulillah, after the revelation of the glorious Quran, this evil practice had discontinued in Arabia. Islam, as I said, is the first religion which uplifted the woman. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the major benefactor. Now, after Islam has given equal rights to the woman, Islam says it is the duty of the woman to maintain the level of modesty. Uplifted the woman, it's their duty to maintain it. And people talk about the hijab, about the veil, you know, the hijab in Islam, etc. And always talk about the hijab of the woman, hijab of the woman. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the glorious Quran, first speaks about the hijab for the man and then of the woman. If you read the Quran, Quran says in Surah Nur, chapter number 24, verse number 30, that say to the believing man that he should lower his gaze and guard his modesty. That whenever a man looks at a woman and any brazen thought comes in his mind, any unashamed thought comes in his mind, he should lower his gaze. First, the Quran mentions the hijab of the male. There was once a friend of mine, who was a Muslim, who was staring at a girl for a long time. So I told him, brother, what are you doing? It's not allowed in Islam. So he told me, brother, our beloved Prophet said that the first glance is allowed. I have not yet completed half my glance. What did the Prophet mean when he said that the first glance is allowed? The Prophet didn't mean that you can look at a woman and without blinking look at her for 10 minutes and then say, you know that my glance is not complete. What the Prophet meant that if you look at a woman unintentionally, don't again look at her intentionally and stare at her with an unashamed eye. That doesn't mean you can look at a woman and feast at her for a long time. That's what the Prophet meant. Intentionally don't look at her. Again, don't feast on her beauty, etc. The next verse of the glorious Quran, Surah Nur, chapter 24, verse number 31, speaks about the hijab for the woman. It says, say to the believing woman that she should lower her gaze and guard her modesty and display not her beauty except what appears ordinarily off. And draw her veil, a head covering over the bosom. Except in front of her husband, her father, her son, and a big list of mahram, the close relatives which she can't marry is given. Among these people, she can relax her hijab. Otherwise, amongst all the other people, she should maintain the hijab. And the criteria for hijab is given in the glorious Quran, as well as the Sahih Hadith, that basically there are six criteria. The first is the extent which differs between the man and the woman. For the man, it's from the navel to the knee. For the woman, the complete body should be covered. The only part that can be seen are the face and the hands up to the wrist. Some scholars say that even this should be covered. But the minimum is to be covered except the face and the hands up to the wrist. The remaining five criteria are the same for the man and the woman. The second is the clothes they wear. It should not be so tight that it reveals the figure. The third is it should not be transparent so that you can see through. Fourth, it should not be so glamorous that it attracts the opposite sex. Fifth, it should not resemble that of the unbeliever. You cannot wear clothes that resemble, which are signs, which are identity of unbelievers, like cross, sign of Christianity, Om, sign of Hinduism. And the last is, you should not wear clothes that which resemble the opposite sex. You know, you have in the Western country, people wearing one earring, you know? Men wearing one earring. It has certain indication, one earring. All this is not allowed in Islam. And the reason for hijab for the woman has been described in the glorious Quran in Surah Ahzab, chapter number 33, verse number 59, which says, O Prophet, tell your wives and the believing women that when they go abroad, they should put on the cloak so that they shall be recognized and it will prevent them from being molested. The Quran says that hijab has been prescribed for the women so that they shall be recognized and it will prevent them from being molested. I want to ask you a question. Let's suppose there are two sisters who are twins and who are equally beautiful. They're very beautiful. And they're walking down the streets of Singapore. One is wearing the Islamic hijab, complete body covered, except the face and the handle up to the wrist. And the second sister, she's wearing the Western clothes, the skirt or the mini. And when they're walking down the streets of Singapore, around the corner, there is a hooligan. There's a ruffian who's waiting for a catch, who's waiting to tease a girl. I am asking a question, which girl will he tease? Will he tease the girl wearing the Islamic hijab or will he tease the girl wearing the skirt or the mini? Which girl will he tease? Which one will he tease? The one wearing the skirt or the mini, but natural. So Quran rightly says that hijab has been prescribed so that it will prevent them from being molested. You know the Western world, they talk about women's liberalization. The Western talk of women's liberalization is nothing but a disguised form of exploitation of her body, of deprivation of honor and degradation of her soul. The Western society, claiming to uplift the woman, have actually degraded her to the status of a concubine, of a mistress, of society butterflies, which are mere tools in the hands of sex marketers and pleasure seekers, which are hidden behind the colorful screen of art and culture. Islam has uplifted the woman. And I said, it's their duty to maintain their status. That is the reason that Islam prescribes hijab to maintain the modesty of the woman, not to degrade or to subjugate her. The other common question asked by the non-Muslim is, I have placed it number 4, is that when Islam is a religion of peace, how come it was spread by the sword? No, Islam is a religion of peace, then how come it was spread by the sword? Islam comes from the root word salam, as I mentioned, which means peace. It also means submitting your will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to Almighty God. In short, Islam means peace acquired by submitting your will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Islam is a religion which wants to spread peace throughout the world. But there are some people, some human beings, who do not want peace to prevail in the world for their own benefits. You know, so that they can have certain benefits for their own material desires. And we know there are such people. To prevent such people, you may even have to use force. That's the reason that the police many a times uses force on the criminals to spread peace. So sometimes you may have to use force to let peace prevail in the world. Similarly, Islam is a religion of peace, but sometimes it says that when there are some people who prevent the spreading of the peace, you can use force to put them in their place so that the peace can prevail in the world. The best reply to this question posed by non-Muslims, that Islam was spread by the is given by a very famous historian by the name of Dilesi Oleri in the book Islam at the Crossroad on page number 8. And he says that history makes it clear that the legend of fanatical Muslims sweeping across the world, forcing Islam at the point of the sword over conquered races, is the most fantastically absurd myth that historians have ever repeated. You know, we Muslims, we ruled Spain for about 800 years. We didn't use the sword. Later on, the Crusaders came and they wiped out the Muslims. There was not a single Muslim who could openly give the Adhan. We didn't use the sword. We Muslims, alhamdulillah, we were the masters of Arabia for the past 1400 years. The Arabs, the ruling Arabia, for the past 1400 years. For a few years, the Britishers came. For a few years, the French came. But overall, we were ruling Arabia and still, alhamdulillah, ruling for the past 1400 years. And do you know today, there are 14 million Arabs who are Coptic Christians. Coptic Christian means they're Christians since birth, since generations. The fathers, the forefathers are Christian. 14 million Coptic Christians you have today who are Arabs. If the Muslims wanted, we could have converted each and every Arab at the point of the sword. These 14 million Coptic Christians or Arabs, they are bearing witness that Islam wasn't spread by the sword. India, the country where I come from, do you know that we Muslims, we ruled India for 1,000 years. If we wanted, we could have converted each and every non-Muslim at the point of the sword. But we didn't do it. You know, today, there are more than 80% Indians who are non-Muslims. These 80% non-Muslims Indian, they are giving shahada. They are bearing witness that Islam wasn't spread by the sword. Today, the country which has the maximum population of Muslims is Indonesia. I am asking you the question, which Muslim army went to Indonesia? Which Muslim army went to Malaysia? Which Muslim army went to the east coast of Africa? Which sword? Thomas Carlyle, who's a famous historian, he gives the reply. Sword, indeed it is the sword. You have to get the sword. Every new opinion initially originates in the mind of one. One man against the whole world. In one man's mind, it dwells alone. It will do little good that he takes the sword and tries to spread it. You have to get your sword. Which sword is talking about? Even if we had the metal sword, we could not use it. Because the Quran says in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 256, like Rahafiddin, there is no compulsion in religion. Truth stands out clear from error. You have to present the truth to them. You cannot force anyone to convert at the point of the sword or the point of the gun. You have to present the truth. If they accept it, alhamdulillah. If they don't accept it, no problem. The sword which Thomas Carlyle is talking about is the sword of the intellect. As the glorious Quran says in Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 125, Udu ila sabili rabbika bil hikmah, wal mawzit al hasna, wajadilum billati ahsan. That is, invite all to the way of thy Lord with wisdom and beautiful preaching and argue with them and reason with them in the ways that are best and most gracious. It is the sword of wisdom, sword of hikmah, sword of intellect. There was an article which came in the Plain Truth magazine. It was a reproduction of an article which came in the Reader Digest Almanac, yearbook 1986. And it gave the statistics of the increase of the major world religion between 1934 to 1984. In the span of 50 years, it gave the increase of the major world religion. Number one was Islam, 235%. Christianity, only 47%. I am asking the question, which war took place between 1934 and 1984 which converted millions of people to Islam? Which war? Which war? Today, the fastest growing religion in America is Islam. The fastest growing religion in Europe is Islam. I am asking you, which sword is asking these Westerners to revert to Islam? Which sword? Who is forcing them today? The fastest growing religion in America and Europe today is Islam. Dr. Adam Pearson says, he gives a very good reply, that people who worry that one day nuclear weaponry will fall in the hands of the Arabs, they fail to realize that the Islamic bomb has already been dropped. It fell the day Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was born. The fifth common question that can be posed is, you Muslims, you all are fundamentalists. You all are terrorists. All you Muslims are fundamentalists and terrorists. How do you reply to such a question posed by a non-Muslim? What is the meaning of the word fundamentalist? A fundamentalist is a person who follows the fundamentals. For example, for a person to be a good mathematician, he should know, he should follow and practice the fundamentals of maths. He should be a fundamentalist in the field of maths to be a good mathematician. For a person to be a good scientist, he should know, he should follow and practice the fundamentals of science. He should be a fundamentalist in the field of science to be a good scientist. For a person to be a good doctor, he should know, he should follow and practice the fundamentals of medicine. He should be a fundamentalist in the field of medicine to be a good doctor. You cannot paint all fundamentalists as good or all fundamentalists as bad. You have to analyze in which field are they fundamentalists in. For example, you may have a fundamentalist robber who is expert in robbing, who's made a lifestyle as robbing. Is he good or bad? For the society, he's harmful. He's a bad person. On the other hand, you have a fundamentalist doctor who knows his medicine very well. He treats the people. He cures hundreds of people. And he prevents many people from dying. He's a fundamentalist doctor. Is he good or bad for society? He's beneficial for the society. He's a good fundamentalist. So you can't paint all fundamentalists with the same brush. All of them are good, all of them are bad. Depending on which field are they a fundamentalist in. Alhamdulillah, I am a fundamentalist Muslim. I know, I follow, and alhamdulillah, the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I strive to practice the fundamentals of Islam. I am a fundamentalist Muslim. And I am proud to be a fundamentalist Muslim. You know why? Because I know that each and every teaching of Islam is beneficial for the whole of humankind. There is not a single teaching of Islam which any human being on the face of the earth can show me which is detrimental to the human race as a whole. Some people may think, this teaching is not good because of the misconception of Islam. They may think, this particular aspect of Islam not to have spoke. Oh, it's not correct because they don't have in-depth knowledge. But anyone who's unbiased and has correct knowledge cannot show me a single teaching of Islam which is against humanity. Therefore, alhamdulillah, I am a fundamentalist Muslim and I am proud to be a fundamentalist Muslim. And every Muslim, to be a good Muslim, he should be a fundamentalist. Then only will be a good Muslim. The moment anyone says you're a fundamental Muslim, no, we aren't fundamentalists. What do you want? You have to be a fundamentalist. If you're not a fundamentalist Muslim, you're not a Muslim at all. That means you're a pseudo-Muslim. You know, many people, they're apologetic. Anyone attacks you, you go on the defend. No, I'm not a fundamentalist. No, those other people, I'm not. I'm a good Muslim. How can you be a good Muslim and not a fundamentalist? You have to be a fundamentalist to be a good Muslim. Fundamentalist in the field of Islam. Now, when you look up the meaning of the word fundamentalism in the Webster dictionary, it will tell you that fundamentalism was a movement which started in the early part of the 20th century by a group of Protestant Christians who protested that people first said that the teachings of the Bible is the word of God. But these people protested, not only are the teachings, but every letter, every word of the Bible is verbatim the word of God. So fundamentalism was a word used first time to describe the movement started by a group of Protestant American Christians who said that every word in the Bible is the word of God. If anyone can prove that the Bible is God's word, it's a good movement. But on the other hand, if anyone can prove that Bible is not the word of God, it's not a good movement. But when you look up the meaning of the word fundamentalist, in the Oxford Dictionary, it says that fundamentalist is a person who strictly adheres to ancient teachings or doctrine, especially Islam. Especially Islam is there in the Oxford Dictionary. So the moment you hear the word fundamentalist, you think of a Muslim. The moment you hear the word fundamentalist, immediately at the back of your mind, because I've read the Oxford Dictionary, it has to be a Muslim. And immediately you start thinking, fundamentalist. Terrorist. Along with the word fundamentalist, the word terrorist is also attached. If he's a Muslim, he has to be a fundamentalist, he has to be a terrorist. I tell my non-Muslim friends and my brothers that, do you know, it's a duty of every Muslim to be a terrorist. He's shocked. What is Zakir saying? That every Muslim should be a terrorist. Now I try and explain to him, what's the meaning of the word terrorist? A terrorist is a person who causes terror. You know the policeman? Whenever a robber sees a policeman, he's terrified. The policeman is a terrorist for the robber. Right or wrong? In the same way, every Muslim should be a terrorist for the anti-social element. Whenever any anti-social element looks at a Muslim, if he's a Muslim, he should be terrified. Any rapist, any robber, any thief, when he looks at a Muslim, he should be terrified. This Muslim, no, they will put me behind bars. Every Muslim should be a terrorist for the anti-social element. I am aware that the word terrorist is more commonly used for causing terror to the innocent people. In that context, no Muslim should ever be a terrorist.
He should not at all terrify any innocent person. He should be a selective terrorist. Terrorist only to the antisocial element. Many a times, the activity of one particular individual is given two different labels. Same person, same activity, but two different labels given by two different groups of people. So let me give you an example. You know, India, previously, it was being ruled by the British government. They came for doing business, but they started ruling India for a couple of centuries. There were many Indians who prescribed to the violent method to try and acquire freedom. Now, these people who tried to free India, these Indians who tried to free India, by the British government, they were called as terrorists. But the same Indians, by the Indians, they were called as patriots. Same people, same activity, two different labels. One group is calling them as terrorists, the other group is calling them as patriots, as freedom fighters. Now, before you give a label to any particular individual, you have to first analyze the background. If you agree with the view of the British government that Britain had a right to rule India, then you will call these people as terrorists. But if you agree with the view of the Indians that the British people, they only came to business, you know, and then they ended up ruling us for hundreds of years, they had no right to rule us. If you agree with their view, then you'll call the same people, the same individual, as freedom fighters, as patriots. Same people, same activity, two different labels. Therefore, before you label anyone, try and analyze the background. And then give your view. So in this context, in the correct context, every Muslim should be a fundamentalist Muslim and should be a terrorist to the antisocial element. The other question the sixth common question.
Oh boy.
That you Muslims, you know, you all are ruthless people. You all are merciless people. You know, you all have non-veg. You all kill animals. You know, you should be vegetarian. Why do you have non-veg? You know, killing the animals, you know, poor living creatures, killing them. You all are ruthless people. And this question is more often posed by Indians, which alhamdulillah, now you find them throughout the world. There are many non-Muslim Indians who are pure vegetarian, and they say that, you know, why are your Muslims so ruthless? Why do you all kill the animals, etc.? I would like to mention that a Muslim can be a very good Muslim even by being a pure vegetarian. He can be. If he wants to be a good Muslim, he can be a good Muslim even by being a pure vegetarian. But the question is, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us permission to have non-veg, why should we not have non-veg? That's the basic question. Allah says in the glorious Quran, in Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 1, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, O you who believe, lawful for you are all four-footed animal with the exception named. Quran says in Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 5, that Allah has created for you cattle, and from it you derive warmth, and in it are various benefits, and of the meat you can eat. Quran says in Surah Mu'minun, chapter 23, verse number 21, that verily in the cattle is a lesson for you. We give you to drink from what is within the body, and from it you derive various benefits, and of the meat you can eat. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us permission to have non-veg, why should we not have non-veg? And if you analyze that meat, it's rich in protein, it's rich in iron, it's rich in vitamin B1, it's rich in niacin, it's nutritious. In fact, in the vegetables, you will not find a good quality protein at all in the vegetables. And if you analyze the set of teeth of the herbivorous animal, the cow, the goat, the sheep, if you look at the set of teeth, they have a flat set of teeth. If you analyze the set of teeth of the carnivorous animal, the tiger, the leopard, the lion, they have got pointed teeth. They have canine teeth. If you go in the mirror and look at our set of teeth, the human beings, we have pointed teeth as well as flat teeth. If Almighty God wanted us to have only vegetables, why did He give us this pointed teeth? For what? To have non-veg. If he wanted us to have only vegetables, we would have given a flat set of teeth. We look in the mirror every time, but we don't realize that. Allah has shown us signs. And if you analyze the digestive system of the herbivorous animal, the cow, the goat, the sheep, they can only digest vegetables. They cannot digest non-veg. The digestive system of the carnivorous animal, the lion, the tiger, the leopard, they can only digest non-veg, they cannot digest vegetables. But the digestive system of the human beings can digest veg as well as non-veg. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Almighty God, wanted us to have only vegetables, why did he give us a digestive system which can digest both veg as well as non-veg? But natural to have it. If you analyze, many Hindus who say that we are pure vegetarian, if you read their scriptures, it's mentioned in the scriptures that their sages, their saints, they had non-veg. And if you read the Ayodhya Khandam, chapter number 20, chapter 26, as well as chapter number 94, it says that when Ram was sent for Banvas, he told his mother that I will have to sacrifice my tasty meat dishes. When Ram said that he will have to sacrifice his tasty meat dishes, that means he had meat. When Ram can have meat, why can't you have meat? Many people may not know the finer details of Raman, but they know the broad outline. And surely they know the story that when Ram was sent for Banvas, along with him went his wife Sita. And one day Sita asked Ram to kill the buck, the deer. The question I want to pose them is, that why did Sita ask Ram to kill the buck? Why? Why did Sita ask Ram to kill the deer? There may be some Hindus who will say that Sita wanted a pet. I ask them, what will Sita do with a dead pet? If she wants a pet, it should be a live pet. The only reason that Sita told Ram to kill the buck was to have its meat. When Ram and Sita can have meat, why can't you and I have meat? So if you analyze the Hindu scriptures, do give permission for a person to have non-veg. But later on, because of the influence of the other religions, like Jainism, etc., to prevent people from adopting their way of life, they started adopting vegetarianism. And when you ask these people who believe in pure vegetarianism, that why don't you have non-veg? So they say that, see, eating non-veg is a sin. You ask them why? See, because killing living creatures is a crime. By having non-veg, you're killing animals, you're killing living creatures. So I tell them, Alhamdulillah, if a person can survive in this world without killing living creatures, I would be the first one to follow it. You know, because what they say about plants, today science tells us that even plants are living creatures. Previously, they did not know about that. Previously, they thought that plants weren't living creatures. Even plants have got life. So the logic has changed. The logic has changed. And even when you breathe in germs, which are living organisms. You cannot survive for 5 minutes without killing living organisms. So now the logic has changed. See, plants are living creatures, but the plants, they can't feel pain. Therefore, killing a plant is a lesser crime as compared to killing animals. Very good logic. The plants can't feel pain. Today, science tells us that the plants can even feel pain. They can even cry. They can even feel happy. Do you know that? But the cry of the plant cannot be heard by the human ear, because the human ear can only hear between frequency of 20 cycles per second to 20,000 cycles per second. Anything below or above this, the human ear can't hear. Have you heard of the silent dog whistle? The master whistles and the dog comes running, but the human beings can't hear. Because the dog can hear up to 40,000 cycles per second. So the whistle that the master blows is between 20,000.
And then we're safe. It's over.
The dog hears and comes running to the master. There was a farmer in America who converted the cry of the plants to the human audible level. And you could immediately come to know when did the plant cry, if it had any problems, it required water. So even the today's science say that the plants can even feel pain, they can even cry, but you cannot hear their pain. And there was a non-Muslim who had a maximum argument with me. And he told me that, see, Brother Zakir, I agree with you that in the plants, they have got life, they can feel pain. But in the plants have got only 3 senses. The animals have got 5 senses. Therefore, killing animals is a greater crime. So I told him, okay, for sake of argument, I agree with you. For sake of argument, I agree with you. The plants have got 3 senses, animals have got 5 senses. So I asked him, my dear brother, suppose you have a younger brother who's born deaf and dumb. Can't hear, can't speak, two senses less. After he grows up, there's a man who comes and kills him. So will you go and tell the judge, oh me lord, give the murderer less punishment because my brother had two senses less? Will you go and tell like that? In fact, you will go and tell the judge, me lord, give this criminal a bigger punishment because he has killed a masoom. He has killed an innocent person who couldn't even fight back. So Islamic logic doesn't work like that, two senses or three senses or five senses. Allah says in the glorious Quran, in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 168, that eat of the good things that we have provided you. What is good, you can have. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, divine wisdom, he knows what our requirement is. Therefore, if you analyze, that if suppose I agree with non-Muslim, that everyone should be a pure vegetarian. Everyone. Do you know the world will be overpopulated with cattle? Because the gestation period of the cattle is very small. You kill a million, another million will be born. So if you stop having them, we have a problem of overpopulation of human beings. From tomorrow, we'll have overpopulation of cattle. You know, Allah has made them in such a way that the gestation period is small and the reproduction is very fast. And personally, if a non-Muslim doesn't have non-veg, I've got no problem. I'm happy, in fact. I'll tell you the reason. But if he comes and tells me, that brother Zakir, why do you have non-veg? Then there's a problem. I tell them, why I shouldn't have? If he doesn't have non-veg, I'm happy. You know why? Because suppose every Indian, non-Muslim, starts having non-veg, then the price of the meat will go high. So, you know, I may have to pay more money. So where it comes to non-Muslim not having non-veg, I've got no problem. But when he comes and interferes with me and saying, you're doing something wrong, then I explain to him the reason. Then there may be some non-Muslims, question number 7, that you know what you eat has an effect on your behavior. Whatever you eat, today science tells us, whatever you eat has an effect on your behavior. You Muslims, you'll eat animals and you behave like animals. Our Muslims are violent and ruthless, you know. And today science says that what you eat has an effect on your behavior. You all are ruthless people. I tell to these non-Muslim brothers, I agree with you, brother. I agree with you that whatever you eat has an effect on your behavior. Science has said that and I agree with it. That's the reason we Muslims, we are not allowed to have carnivorous animal. We are only allowed to have herbivorous animal like cow, goat, sheep, you know, which are peaceful animal, docile animal, and we are peace-loving people. We aren't allowed to have tiger, leopard, you know, who are ferocious and violent. We only have peaceful animals. And the glorious Quran says that you have to follow the command of the beloved Prophet. It's mentioned for Araf, chapter number 7, verse number 157, that the messenger commands you that which is just and forbids you that which is evil. The Prophet allows you that which is good for you and prohibits you that which is impure for you. It's again repeated in Surah Al-Hashr, chapter 59, verse number 7, that take what the Prophet assigns to you and abstain from that which he denies you. And there are several Sahih Hadith in Sahih Muslim, in Sahih Bukhari, in which the Prophet has clearly mentioned that you should not have carnivorous animal. And he gives a list of prohibited food. The first is the carnivorous animal, which have got canine teeth, you know, like cat, dog, hyena, leopard, lion, etc. You can't have certain rodents like rat, mice, rabbits with claws. You can't have certain reptiles like poisonous snakes, alligators, etc. You can't have birds of prey which have got talons and claws like vultures, owls, eagles. All these category is prohibited for the Muslim. So what the Prophet says, we believe. Atiullah wa atiur Rasul. Therefore, we are only allowed to have herbivorous animals, the cattle, which are peace-loving. There are some non-Muslims who do have non-veg, but they say, you know, you Muslims, you have non-veg, no problem. But why do you kill the animal in such a ruthless manner? You know, kill him with mercy. You all torture him to death, you kill animal writhes and kicks and bleeds to death. You all are merciless people, you Muslims. You want to have non-veg? We have no objection. But at least kill the animal mercifully. Why do you torture him to death? Once there was an argument going on between a Muslim and a Sikh. You know, Sikh is a person from India who has a turban. They were having an argument, same argument. You Muslims, all are ruthless people. You all torture the animal, etc. So our Muslim brother, he used his hikmah, and he said that we Muslims, you know, we do zabiha. You know why? You all Sikhs, you all are coward people. You all attack from behind. We Muslims, we are brave. Marat ka bacha, we attack from the front. No, because the Sikhs, when they slaughter the animal, they give jhatka, fat, one shot and animal dies. So the Muslims said, you all are coward attacking from behind. We are marat ka bacha, we attack from the front. Anyway, this is not the reason why we do zabiha. This was just a joke. This is just a joke which has taken place really. But this is not the reason why we do zabiha. The reason why we Muslims do zabiha, and zabiha has been derived from zaka or taskiya, meaning to purify, to grow. And there are various rules and regulations of zabiha. You can give a talk only on the rules and regulations. But the major ones are that, you know, that the knife should be sharp, it should be a swift cut. And there are many that you should give water to the animal before slaughtering it. You should not slaughter one animal in front of the other, various. But the main scientific reason is that you also cut the throat and the windpipe and the vessels of the neck, the jugular vein and the carotid arteries. When you do zabiha, we cut the throat, windpipe, and the vessels of neck without damaging the spinal cord. Because if the spinal cord is damaged, the nerve going to the heart may get severed, may get cut. There may be cardiac arrest. The blood will stagnate in the body. So when we do zabiha, we cut the windpipe, throat, and vessels of neck, and the heart is yet pumping. The animal doesn't die immediately. And most of the blood flows out. The reason why we let the blood flow out of the body is because today we have come to know that blood is a good media of germ and bacteria and toxins. We are hygienic people. We let majority of the blood flow out of the body. If we have along with the meat, the blood, it contains germs, bacteria, toxins. And if we slaughter, give one jhatka, the blood remains, which is not good for health. And besides that, meat which is slaughtered by zabiha method remains fresh for longer time because of lack of blood, as compared to meat slaughtered by jhatka or by stunning method. And alhamdulillah, you know, last time I came to Singapore, I was very happy that the McDonald's, you know, halal, Pizza Hut, halal, alhamdulillah, you know. There are problems in the Western world, you know. You can't have the meat from these people. Alhamdulillah, I was very happy. And hardly 15 to 18% Muslims, alhamdulillah. That's very good. Even the non-Muslim have realized that that's the most scientific method. If you compare, which is more merciful? The stunning method or the zabiha method? Scientific research tells us today that the zabiha method is more merciful. You know why? Because when you do zabiha, the blood supply going to the nerve, which is responsible for feeling the pain, is stopped. So the animal does not feel pain. The animal kicks and writhes because of lack of blood. When the blood flows out of the body, the animal kicks and writhes. When there's less blood in the arm, the muscles will contract and relax. The legs will start contracting and relaxing. So the animal kicks and writhes not due to pain, due to lack of blood in that part of the body. Due to gush or flow of blood. The animal does not feel pain. It dies a merciful death. As compared to stunning, many a time when the first shot is given, the animal doesn't die, and the animal actually later on dies after a long time with crucial pain. So even scientifically, the zabiha method is much more merciful as compared to the stunning method. There are many non-Muslims who may ask question number 9, that your Muslims say that idol worship is not allowed, it is haram. Then why do you all bow to the Kaaba? You all worship the Kaaba. The stone which is maximum worship is the Kaaba. Why do you bow to the Kaaba? If you're like it's idol worship. No Muslim ever worships the Kaaba. No Muslim. We worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Kaaba is our Qibla. It's the direction. It's the Qibla. Direction in which we pray. Because we Muslims believe in unity. And if suppose we offer Salah in this hall, some may say let's pray towards the north. Some may say left face south, some may say east. Which direction will we face? So for unity, every Muslim faces towards the Kaaba. If you are living on the north side of Kaaba, you face towards the south. If you are living on west of Kaaba, you face towards the east. If you're living on the east of Kaaba, you face towards the west. Whichever part of the world you are, you face towards the Kaaba. That's the Qibla. And the first people who drew the map, the geography map, were the Muslims. You know, they had the South Pole on the top and North Pole down at the bottom. And Alhamdulillah, Kaaba was in the center. Wherever I want to pray, face towards the center of the earth. The Westerners came and they turned the map upside down. North Pole on top, South Pole down. But yet, Alhamdulillah, Kaaba is yet in the center. Kaaba is our Qibla. And when we go for Hajj and Umrah, when we do Tawaf around the Kaaba, we circumambulate around the Kaaba. The reason we circumambulate around the Kaaba is to testify, as we know, that every circle has got only one center. A circle cannot have two centers. So we circumambulate around the Kaaba to testify that there is only one Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is only one God. And the best answer was given by the second Khalifa of Islam, Hazrat Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, which is mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, poem number 2, in the book of Hajj, chapter number 56, hadith number 675, Hazrat Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, said that I am kissing this black stone. Kissing this black stone because my Prophet kissed it. Otherwise, this black stone can neither benefit me, neither can cause me harm. Hazrat Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, said, this black stone can neither benefit me, can neither cause me harm. I am only touching and kissing it because my beloved Prophet did it. This statement of the second Khalifa of Islam, Hazrat Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, is sufficient to prove that we Muslims don't worship the Kaaba. And another point that can be told to the non-Muslim is that during the time of the Prophet, the Sahabas used to stand on the Kaaba and give the azan. I am asking you, which idol worshipper will ever stand on the idol which he worships? Any idol worshipper will stand on the idol he worships? Never. So this is sufficient proof that we Muslims don't worship the Kaaba. The 10th question, which is a common question, is that when Islam is a universal religion, why don't you allow non-Muslims to enter Makkah and Medina? It's a common question. I happen to be an Indian. Even though I'm an Indian, there are certain areas in India which are known as cantonment area. Every country has certain cantonment area known as the military area, you know, where only those people involved with the defense of the country, they are allowed. I am a citizen of India, but I am not allowed to go in the cantonment area. Why? Only those people who are involved with defense of the country, they are allowed there. No one else. Similarly, the Haramain, Makkah and Medina, they are the cantonment area of the Muslims. You know, Islam is for the full world. But only those people who are involved in protecting and fighting and defending Islam, only they are allowed in the cantonment area of Makkah and Medina. And Allah gives a promise in the glorious Quran, in Surah Tawbah, chapter number 9, verse number 28. From this day, do not allow the non-believers to enter Makkah and Medina, the Haramain, the sacred places. And furthermore, whenever you visit any country, you require a visa. Any country you want to go, you have to apply for a visa. Without visa, you cannot enter. And USA is a country which is the most difficult to get a visa, especially for third world country people. You know? And when you apply for the visa, they ask you several questions. Question number 1, 2, 3, you have to reply. And then judging on that, they will either refuse your visa or grant you visa. You know, when I came to Singapore, I had to apply for a visa. Last moment, you know, visa, the formalities. Last time when I had come 2 years back, when I filled the immigration form, this time I didn't fill, I don't know what's the new form. But last time when I came to Singapore, I filled the immigration form, it mentioned death to drug traffickers. Death to drug traffickers. I cannot say, oh, death penalty, barbaric law. If I don't believe in it, I don't enter Singapore. If I want to enter Singapore, I have to agree with the law. That if I'm carrying drugs, I'll be put to death. I can't say, oh, drug penalty, very barbaric law, I don't agree. Don't agree, don't come. See, there are visa formalities. You have to agree. If you want to enter Singapore, if you're carrying drugs, you will be put to death. You can't argue. The visa requirement. Similarly, for entering Makkah and Medina, you require a visa. The visa to enter Makkah and Medina is to say with your lips, La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. There's no God but Allah and Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, the messenger of Allah. If you say this, then no one can deny you entering to Makkah and Medina. That's a visa. I've only covered 10 questions, half of the questions, and the time is running short. 3-4 minutes are remaining. I will just go to the last two questions, which are short. I've covered 10 questions. The remaining, if you wish, you can alter in question answer time. Brought it about 1 hour, 15 minutes to 1.5 hour to speak on. I'll just go to the 19th and 20th question, which are small and which are related. I've finished 10 questions. I'll just skip the 8 questions and go to the last two questions, which are short. The answers are short. And the 19th question is, that, you know, Islam is such a beautiful religion. You spoke so good things about Islam. But the Muslims, they are dishonest. You know, they cheat. And they do illegal activities. So when Islam is such a good religion, but the Muslims, you know, they are the worst people. How do you reply? How do you reply to such an allegation? The main reason that this atmosphere has been created, that Muslims are robbers and cheats and ruthless people, is again by the media. You know, the media, the Westerners, they're afraid of Islam. The religion that can take Europe today, the only religion that can take is Islam. No other religion. They're afraid of Islam. So they're projecting Islam in the wrong way. You know, they are controlling the media. And you see that whenever any bomb blast takes place, first person, Muslim. With the Oklahoma bomb blast, it took place, Middle East conspiracy. Later on, they came to know it was an American soldier. But the news of Muslims as fundamentalist terrorists will come on front page, and when it's proved wrong, it comes inside, you know. You know, they make a big, it has to be a Muslim, has to be a Muslim. For weeks together, when they find the real culprit, only one day it will come in small news, you know, that, okay, it wasn't a Muslim. You know, when in India, suppose, a Muslim, if he marries a 15-year-old girl, a 50-year-old man marries a 15-year-old girl, it comes on the head page, headline, front page. 50-year-old man marrying a 15-year-old girl. With permission. Comes in front page. He's taking permission of the girl, of the parents. But front page. When a non-Muslim, 50-year-old man rapes a 6-year-old girl, it comes in news brief. News brief and inside pages, you know. Small, only one paragraph. A 50-year-old man raped a 6-year-old girl. This is controlled by the media. The media projects Islam in the wrong way. I am aware that there are black sheep in the community. Every community has a black sheep. Even in a Muslim, alhamdulillah, I do know that there are black sheep in the community. I do know that there are Muslims who are dishonest. I do know there are Muslims who cheat. I do know Muslims who can drink the non-Muslim under the table. They can have alcohol, much more. They can have more number of pegs, more number of bottles than non-Muslims. I'm aware of that. But the media picks up these Muslim black sheep and projects them as exemplary Muslims. They pick up a black sheep and say, all Muslims are like that. See, if Hitler insinuated 6 million Jews, can I blame Christianity for that? Can I? Hitler insinuated 6 million Jews. Can I say Christianity did that? No. So the media picks up these black sheep and projects them as exemplary Muslims. If you analyze as a whole, Muslims as a whole in the world, we are the biggest community of teetotalers which don't imbibe alcohol. Do you know that? Biggest community as a whole which don't imbibe alcohol. We are the biggest community as a whole which give the maximum charity in the world. There is not a non-Muslim who can show the Muslims even a candle as far as sobriety is concerned, as far as modesty is concerned, as far as human values are concerned, as far as ethics are concerned. There is not a non-Muslim who can show us a candle as a whole. They pick up samples, black sheep, and they project as though they're exemplary. For example, suppose you want to test a new model Mercedes, you know, a new model has come out in the market, the latest 1998, maybe a new model E200, the latest 98 model has come out, and you want to check the Mercedes Benz, how good it is. You ask a person to sit behind the steering wheel who doesn't know how to drive. He goes and bangs up the car. Who will you blame, the car or the driver? Who will you blame, the car or the driver? The driver. The driver didn't know how to drive the car and he banged up the car. Similarly, if you want to judge Islam, don't judge by the followers. Judge by the authentic source, the Quran and the Sahih Hadith. Judge by Quran and Sahih Hadith and you'll come to know there's no religion better than Islam. And if you want to put a driver, put an expert driver. If you want to judge Islam by any follower, the best exemplary Muslim is our beloved Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He's the best example. No wonder many non-Muslims have paid tribute to him. If you have read the book by Mikaeel, the 100 most influential people in the world, right from Adam, peace be upon him, till the present time, he gave number one to our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Number one. Though being a non-Muslim, he was honest. Thomas Carlyle has praised the Prophet. There are hundreds of them. So if you want to judge Islam by the followers, the best exemplary Muslim is our beloved Prophet. And the last question, the answer of which is short, that many non-Muslims say, that why do you Muslims abuse us by calling kafir? Why do you abuse us by calling us kafir? And the answer is very short. That kafir comes from the root word kufr, which means to reject, to conceal. In the Islamic perspective, kafir means a person who rejects the truth of Islam. The Arabic word kafir means one who rejects the truth of Islam. If you want to translate into English, it means non-Muslim. So when a non-Muslim says that why do you abuse us by calling us kafir, I'm saying kafir is the Arabic translation of non-Muslim. If you really feel bad and you feel that I should not call you a kafir, all you have to do is accept Islam. And I'll stop calling you a kafir. These were 12 of the 20 most common questions. I'll just briefly mention the remaining 8 questions which I didn't touch due to shortage of time. I know the time is up for my talk. I'll just briefly mention the 8 questions which I have not covered, the most 20 common questions. Otherwise, I have a list of more questions. The question that I didn't cover up is that why do Muslims don't have pork? Why is pork prohibited in Islam? Why is the consumption of alcohol prohibited in Islam? That's question number 11th and 12th. Question number 13th is that why are two women witnesses equal to one witness of man? Question number 14 is that when Islam believes in equality, why does the woman inherit half the share of the male counterpart? Number 15, can you prove the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Can you prove the existence of Almighty God? Number 16 is, can you prove that there is life after death? Number 17 is that Islam talks about unity, but there are so many sects in Islam, you are divided amongst yourselves. And the 18th one is that all the religion basically speak about good things. Then why follow only Islam? You can follow any religion. These were the 8 questions which time didn't permit me to cover up. Inshallah, if you have any other question, they're most welcome to ask. If anyone wants to know the answer to these questions, also they're most welcome to come on the mic and ask the question. I would like to end my talk by giving the quotation of the glorious Quran from Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 125, which says, "Udu ila sabili rabbika bil hikma wal mawzit al hasna wa jadil billati ahsan." That is, invite all to the way of their Lord with wisdom and beautiful preaching, and argue with them and reason with them in the ways that are best and most gracious. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.